us with his human love. Amen. Healing comes in many forms, big and small. Jesus was a healer, but he was not unique in the annals of humankind, even though he was extraordinary. The thing that was important about him was that he didn't hold all of this power to himself, saying, look at me, I'm a great healer. He said, this is a sign of God's love, and I want to share it with you, and I want you to become healers too. Then he recruited his disciples, his apprentices. A disciple is someone who comes to learn, and he trained them in his way so that they could become purveyors of healing, small and great. Natural, normal, something, everything we can do, and things that go beyond the ordinary. Healing comes in many forms. When I was on my trip to Albania in the fall, there was a day we had spent the night in an interesting camp left over from the previous communist days, and I woke up sick as a dog, just traveler sickness. But it was rather a miserable day on the bus, I want to tell you, laced only by the most beautiful scenery in the world. Actually, I remember it very fondly, but I was quite ill. And the next morning I got up and I was a little better, and I went. We were in this historic Turkish-style town in Albania, and we were having a presentation about the buildings in the town, and I went to the lecture hall. And one of our tour guides, a young man named Eddie, saw that he said, how are you feeling? And I said, yeah, a little better. And he said, would you like a cup of tea? So I said, thank you very much. So I sat down, he came, he brought the tea. And as he set the tea down, he just put his hand on my shoulder. And it wasn't just, hope you feel better. I could feel something. I could feel it going through my body. Now, I wasn't cured, but I could feel a kind of jolt of energy. Well, it wasn't a jolt. It was a steady flow of energy, and I felt a bit better. I talked to him later about this. He was astounded that I felt this. But I could tell that he's a person who has a caring presence. And it came through his hands. I kid you not. And I'm talking about things that are taught in nursing schools these days. Therapeutic touch is a modern mind-body discipline, a form of energy healing. Energy is our word. The ancient word is spirit. Taught at NYU. Nursing school, used at Mountainside Hospital in Montclair, used at St. Barnabas, because all of us have a natural ability to let caring flow not only through our words, but through our hands. We talk about tender, loving care, and most of us are not aware of it, and the 20th century is in one sense so benighted about spiritual, the 21st century is so benighted about spiritual things that if we're, if we get some tender, loving care, and if we're sick, and our spouse, smooths our furrowed brow, we may feel something, but of course, it's just our imagination. Well, it's not. It's not. It's not. So that's a small form of healing. For example, one Christmas Eve, I was in the procession. There was a man sitting, as we came around and started going up the aisle, there was a man sitting over there whom I knew was really low. His wife had just left him, he was in divorce proceedings. He was feeling pretty low, and he was right next to the aisle. And I don't usually do this, but as we were coming up the aisle, come O ye faithful, I just reached over, patted him on the shoulder. Now I doubt that a jolt of healing energy went out for me, could have, I don't know. But he came to me afterwards and told me that simply the touch of care turned his whole insides in a different direction. Later, I got a note from him telling me how important it is. We never know what gesture may make a huge impact. Jesus says, a cup of cold water given in my name is not without its reward, is not without its effect. So Jesus was actually an extraordinary healer. There have been some in the history of the world. And he saw this. It wasn't just that he healed, it certainly didn't point to himself. He saw this as a sign of God's love coming into the world. He says, if I, by the finger of God, cast out demons, illness, then the kingdom of God has come among you. He saw it as a sign of God's presence among us. And our gospel says he called these men and then he went about healing and preaching all through Galilee. Comes in small forms, comes in bigger forms. I know a Methodist minister. I met her out in South Dakota back in 1996 when I was out there doing a conference for Methodist ministers. And she had a heart defect. And one of her friends invited her to go with her to a Pentecostal prayer meeting, a Pentecostal healing service. Well, this was a Methodist minister who was not in favor of Pentecostal sorts of worship. She was a very rational person. She didn't believe in any spookery or mumbo jumbo, and she sort of very skeptical about Pentecostal claims for healing, but a friend was pressing on her. She went, and all through the services, people were getting more hopped up, and they were clapping their hands, and people were speaking in tongues, and people were raising their hands. She became more reserved. It was not her way of worship. She understood it was theirs, but enough is enough. And so she was very perplexed when the minister invited people to come forward for healing, and her body got up and started going up the aisle. She had a heart defect, and she was going to go in for surgery. There was a tear between the chambers of her heart. She'd been to the doctor, the surgery was scheduled. So her body took her up there, obviously a need in her and a possibility that she did not rationally understand. And as they prayed, and they don't just do what we Episcopalians do, make a sign of the cross and just put their hands on, she was surrounded by a team of people who laid their hands on her and prayed for 5 minutes. She felt something happen. The surgery was canceled. The heart defect was healed. Now, I've got a repository of stories like that. Dozens of stories like that. Things happen. Things really happen when people are open to them. I'm not a big miracle monger, but things happen, small and great, all the way from the touch of kindness to more extraordinary things. If we actually believe that God is trying to make us better. Not going to cure every problem, not every heart defect's going to be cured, but when we're open to the fact that God can flow through us as a channel, we do not know what the effects are going to be. I was called to the emergency room when one of the teenagers in our parish in Calvary Church back in the 1970s was there in agony because he was having his spastic colon was tied in knots. And he was headed for surgery. Now we know a lot about mind-body medicine now that we didn't know. We know that certain attitudes of mind and body can help or hinder healing. It's not the whole story. You can't just make yourself well by thinking, but it is a factor. And I think all of us know that. We rally our energy, we rally our strength. Maybe we're having 50 people for a Christmas reception, and our cold waits until the reception is over and then hits us. We have a little leverage over these things, don't we? Which is why some of us get up on Monday morning or Thursday morning and go to work if we're not feeling so well, which is not necessarily a gift to our fellow workers. We have some leverage here. And that's just the surface of something much deeper that comes through people like Jesus and healers like him. Healers like Agnes Sin, the wife of an Episcopal priest, down in Morristown, New Jersey, who helped revive the ministry of healing in the Episcopal Church. So I was called to the emergency room. Well, I just did my priestly thing. I wasn't in there for miracles. I was in there because I'm a priest. There's a ritual, there's a routine we do in these things. I brought my holy oil, I anointed him on his forehead, as we do at our Wednesday healing service. I prayed for him, and I prayed for him very seriously. And the spasm stopped. And the guts unwound. And there was no surgery. These things happen. Now, all of us are not in the position to even be there and be the channels for this. And I'm not taking credit for it. Give God the glory, as the Pentecostals say. But it's an issue, I'm going to keep coming back to the issue of prayer again and again. We need to keep our roots in God. And one of the ways we do that is by remembering that God is all around us every day. And that God's love can flow through us. Make me an instrument of your peace. Make me an instrument of healing in this situation. Make me an instrument of joy. Some of us have more openness to that than others, but all of us can be more open than we are. We keep ourselves grounded in God by returning again and again, not to be all pious and pray for 5 minutes necessarily, but just to remember that we're living and moving and having our being in God. And our hearts are open to God's love. And we try to keep our hearts clean by the regular practice of forgiveness and thanksgiving and praise. And our hands are ready to help, whether that's lifting furniture, whether that's helping around the church, whether that's working in a food pantry, whether that's serving food in a kitchen for the homeless, or whether it's we have a sick child or a sick relative, and we're holding their hand. But we're not just holding their hand thinking, well, this might comfort them. We're intentionally caring for them. And I invite you even to imagine that your love and your care is flowing through your hand. I'll end with a story from the hospice program at JFK Hospital down south in Edison. I knew the man who ran this program for many years, a Jewish man, a devout man, very interested in healing, actually. And he trained his hospice volunteers in what he called caring touch. That when you go into the hospital, when you even shake hands with somebody, you don't just do it physically. You do it psychologically, too. This happens to you, of course, if you're greeting someone you know very well, you care about, you know, there's something that happens inside you that makes it more than simply skin-to-skin formal touch. You may even clasp the other person's hand for a minute because you are caring about it. It's naturally flowing. This is a God-given gift. But he trained them in a more meditative way to imagine that their caring was flowing through their hands. I took his training program to Calvary Church, to our Stephen Ministry program, which is like our health and healing network. And we had a workshop in which they practiced, you know, going to the person and just, you know, saying hello. And then we did some meditation and prayer. We filled ourselves with the light of God. And then they approached much more slowly and consciously their partner. And as they held, took their hand, they imagined that the light of God was flowing through from their heart to that person's heart. People had various reactions, but all of them said the touch felt different. But one woman had tears were streaming down her eyes. She said, well, I know it was just Bill, but when that happened, God touched me. I felt like it was God touching me. These things happen. Jesus went about healing people and training his disciples to do the same. Whether it's the cup of cold water, whether it's the smile when somebody needs it, whether it's the helping hand, whether it's the listening ear, or whether it's a more potent touch, all of us are called every day.